And now, the Edwin Black Show. Sponsored by the books of Edwin Black. Available on Amazon and at booksellers worldwide. And now, here's Edwin.
Welcome to the Edwin Black Show. I'm Edwin Black, investigative journalist and historian, the author of IBM and the Holocaust, War Against the Weak, and many other books. My Zoom dashboard shows, let's see, we have strong viewership in Michigan, California, as well as the UK, Germany, Israel, Canada, Mexico, and a few places in the Middle East. In addition, thank you for those schools and also those in the European Parliament who are sharing their screen with colleagues, thus multiplying our actual audience. We hope to include as many of you everywhere as possible in today's blunt episode. If you have a question limited to today's topic, place it in Zoom's QA feature or email me, ask@theedwinblackshow. We've already got quite a few, more than 15 or 20 through various modalities. Now, the Edwin Black Show is growing and growing globally. We speak to a fragmented world, seeking better understanding of our tormented past, our present tense, and our future. Still undecided. We are an all-volunteer group across many cities here and in several countries. If you possess the skills and talents and wish to join us, go to join the team at theedwinblackshow.com. Email us, join the team at theedwinblackshow.com. Also, we ask all of our viewers to subscribe at our YouTube channel at The Edwin Black Show on the YouTube. And be sure to hit that notify button. After this episode, our production team adds all sorts of graphics to create a highly enhanced rendition of the episode. That takes some time, so we've been rushing out the unedited episodes to our YouTube channel. So if you missed an earlier episode, you'll probably see it listed. We're up to episode 6. Please get over to the YouTube channel and subscribe to The Edwin Black Show and hit that notify button. Now to today's episode, as we take an up close and personal look at the Iranian nuclear bomb and much more. Iran is not developing a nuclear bomb. They already have one. They have it now. Tehran's nuclear capable requires three things: nuclear gunpowder, nuclear bullets, and a long-range nuclear rifle. I've been covering this topic for years and broke several of the key revelations in the continuing saga. I began my coverage some 13 years ago in December 2007 when I revealed that Russia's S-300 radar system, which was expecting to greatly complicate any Israeli airstrike against those reactors when the time was ripe for a preemptive strike, that system would thwart any such attack. This is why Israel flew a so-called joint training mission with the Greek Air Force flying over Crete, where Greece had installed an earlier version of the S-300 system. This and more allowed Israel to learn to trick what was then Russia's most advanced defense system. They've since replaced it with the S-400, and I believe that Israel will have that one aced as well. 2 years later in 2009, I revealed for the first time that a secret new bunker buster was nearing completion. The precision-guided GBU-57A/B MOP, that is the 30,000-pound massive ordnance penetrator, which was being rushed into readiness to crack through Iran's heavily fortified underground facilities as well as North Korean facilities. In 2012, in a long exclusive in the Times of Israel, I tracked the history of Iran's bomb from its beginnings as a joint effort with the help of North Korea, Pakistan, and China, coordinated by Pakistan's nuclear mastermind, A.Q. Khan, step by step to its current nuclear weapons ready threshold. I explained back then that the threshold depended upon accruing sufficient highly enriched uranium, that's 90% enrichment weapons grade, to create the bomb. This is the nuclear gunpowder. But the numbers have always been hard to understand. Now remember, there's no reason, no research or energy reason for anyone to enrich uranium other than creating a nuclear bomb. But Iran was doing so, molecule by molecule, at breakneck speed. Back in 2012, I explained that while Iran was indeed mostly enriching only 3.5%, which is normally used for reactors, and some 20%, which can be used for some medical isotopes, in fact, those numbers were very deceiving. Enriching uranium requires starting with LEU, that's low enriched uranium, and basically whirling it around at super speeds, thousands of times per second, in those silver centrifuges that you've all seen. This allows the uranium to shed its lighter molecular parts, and the residue becomes denser and denser, slowly marching toward 90% enrichment. In an oversimplification, think of this. Scientists pipe radioactive uranium gas into the centrifuge, which then spins around, separating the lighter U-235 up and leaving the heavier U-238 at the bottom. Then they continue refining and refining the residue. So 3.5% and 20% seem a far-off level of 90% weapons-grade enrichment. False. Think of nuclear enrichment like boiling water. Once a pot of water is half-boiled, it takes just a little more heat to achieve a racing boil. It is the same with weapons material. Once Iran enriches uranium to 3.5%, it is 3/4 of the way home. Once Iran has reached 20%, it has gone roughly 90% of the distance to making that weapons grade uranium. In other words, once the process has been mastered to 90%, it is only a brief matter of time before the 90% bomb quality HEU, highly enriched uranium, can be created. It takes only about 25 kilograms of 90% HEU to make one bomb. Depending upon the number of cascades and centrifuges acting in concert, Iran could now amass some 25 kilograms of bomb-ready 90% HEU in weeks if it does not have it already. Based on their breach of treaty limits earlier this year, they undoubtedly have that quantity and more in-house right now. So much for the gunpowder. They have it now. They have it for the bullet, and the bullet is the warhead. Here's the warhead design that I revealed back in 2012. The atomic bullet is a spheroidal mass requiring the advanced metallurgical infrastructure, that is what you may see in those smelters in the news footage, to metallize and then machine the HEU into a perfectly spheroidal core of pure HEU. It must be small enough to fit the warhead itself. Now, the warhead is an R-265 shock generator comprised of two co-equal hemispheres covered with 1 millimeter grooves filled with PETN explosives that lead down to a 5 millimeter entry point terminal. These PETN grooves or channels will then be centrally exploded. The simultaneous initiation of a high explosive in the outer hemisphere of the shock generator impacts a second interior device known as the exploding bridge wire. The exploding bridge wire is the detonator designed to transduce a massive shock. In other words, it absorbs a great deal of shock, it isn't destroyed, and it transduces it. The timing of this initial explosion will not be measured in seconds or even milliseconds, which are 1/1000ths of a second, but in microseconds. A microsecond is 1/1000000th of a second. Iran has thousands of these highly specialized bridge wires and has already practiced on this microsecond explosive technique. All that force, super simultaneously, will be absorbed and transmitted by the exploding bridge wire, which then sets off the third implosion stage, the neutron initiator. This final effort fires the single neutron into the core, setting off the nuclear explosion and the mushroom cloud. Now delivery, that's the nuclear rifle. That is the Iranian Shahab-3 missile, whose 600 millimeter nose cone is large enough for the warhead diameter, which itself is only 550 millimeters. The Shahab-3 is actually the relabeled North Korean Nodong-1 missile, which itself is based on the Russian Scud-C design from several years ago. Since a precise three-phase explosion is required to set off the nuclear bomb, the Shahab-3 missile is not designed to hit the ground in Israel, but to explode in an airburst 600 meters above the ground, like the two we dropped on Japan. Those were airburst bombs. The Shahab-3 is uniquely suited because it has the air guidance systems to fly 1,500 kilometers to Tel Aviv and then control an airburst at approximately 600 meters above the ground. Moreover, it is structurally able to withstand reentry from the upper atmosphere. It will not burn up, and it is truck mobile, so it can be launched from an orchard one day or a village alley another day. All the information you just heard was certified by the International Atomic Energy Agency by their inspectors in the days before my article was released. I had the scoop. 8 years later, Iran is ready. Israel is ready and has been ready for well over a year. While the last president vetoed an attack, the current president will not. The window for that attack is exceedingly small if it happens. The attack, if it cannot be avoided, is just the beginning. Iran's naval, air, and ground retaliation will have to be neutralized in advance, or it will be a conflagration that we cannot even imagine. Yet Israel has been, in fact, trying to avoid this attack of unknown potential global catastrophic consequences. It has unleashed a years-long campaign of strategic assassinations, technical subterfuge, including the Stuxnet virus that incapacitated key equipment. And in recent days, we've seen an extraordinary number of fires, explosions, industrial accidents, and military attacks trying to avoid the moment we are speaking of today. A lot of people wonder about this nightmare, many years in the making, but people like myself and my guests to follow, we follow it minute to minute. I'm proud to introduce one of the most knowledgeable men on planet Earth with regard to this topic and national security in general, my friend Walid Phares. Walid has been a national security advisor to the European Congress, the House, the Senate, several presidents, and is the author of a series of stunning and revealing books, including, let's see what we have here. We have Future Jihad, Terrorist Strategies Against America, that was published by Palgrave Macmillan, and it was ranked in the top 10 of all such books by the Foreign Affairs List. We have The War of Ideas, an excellent book, also Palgrave Macmillan. We have The Coming Revolution, Struggle for Freedom in the Middle East, Simon & Schuster, which only predicted the Arab Spring a year before it happened. And his latest is The Lost Spring, what happened to that Arab Spring. Now, before I turn it over to Walid, I would like to mention the loss of two wonderful people, two black men that I knew. One is John Lewis, and the other is Herman Cain. John Lewis was a very powerful man, and everything he said and did on those occasions in which I met him, he was awe-inspiring just to meet. Just if you escorted him to his table at a banquet you were attending with him. Herman Cain always had a smile. He was a great man, and so I left one. And from my United Nations glass, to my friend Herman Cain, and someone that I admired, John Lewis. And now I'll turn it over to my friend Walid. Walid, I'm going to...
Hello, can you hear me?
Now I can. It's always a pleasure to hear you. Thank you for joining us. I just want to remind our listeners all around the world that yesterday the four of the biggest giants in the tech world appeared before Congress. We had Facebook, we had Amazon, we had and they had a Zoom collapse. So we're dependent upon Zoom, but through the power of Zoom, we have the opportunity to have one of my great friends and colleagues, Walid Phares. First of all, Walid, did you have anything to say about John Lewis, a tower in this country, and Herman Cain?
Absolutely. I got throughout my briefings in Congress to meet the late congressman on the one hand, but also during the campaigns, I had the opportunity, and at the studio of Fox News, I met with Mr. Cain. And they are both major losses for not just our history, recent history, but human rights in general. And they both would have been needed now in what we are going through in this country. So hopefully from where they are right now, they could help better.
All right. Well, thank you. We certainly could have used both those voices, active and energetic, in the days to come. Now, you heard my description of the Iranian nuclear bomb and all its intricacies. And I wondered if you have an opening remark about the Iranian threat, either on the ground or potentially in the air.
I do. Thank you so much for your wonderful work. Actually, you and I, and you've mentioned this, have been working on this for at least maybe two decades at this point in time, after 9/11, and you have been the strategic technician, in the sense, the scientific analyst in this business. I remember after 9/11 and also around 2006, 2007, that we did multiple events and congressional briefings and God knows. So we're not gonna spend our time on our history, you and I, in this issue, but you have been leading. Let me, for the sake of being fast, so that we can engage with your beautiful audience, just say a couple words adding to what you have already mentioned. I mean, I'm not going to add all the important components that you have brought into the discussion, but let me say, I have observed the strategic intention of the Iranian regime even before I came here as an immigrant 30 years ago. My first book about the future vision then of the Iranian Islamic Revolution, I've published it in 1987 when I was still a young lawyer in Beirut. And that book in Arabic was analyzing all the trends and statements and intentions of that regime since its genesis, which was in 1979. So by 87, in that book, I projected that eventually, and we didn't know that the Cold War was to end in a few years, in 1989 and 90. I projected that the Iranian regime wanted to create a long-range weapon, and they said it at the time, that could balance both superpowers. They were not just thinking about the United States, but even about the Soviet Union. They called both of them as evil. One was the red evil, one, and the other one, the United States, was the blue evil. That's how they called them. Moving forward into after 9/11, there was a critical time with the coming of Ahmadinejad, 2005, and that was as a reaction to the Iranian regime, which was going slow in terms of acquiring the nuclear capabilities and missiles. They always wanted it from day one ideologically. But why did they jump and leap in 05? Because they perceived themselves, their regime, as threatened. We were in Iraq in 2003. We had been in Afghanistan in 2001. Now, prior to that, Hezbollah was under pressure in Lebanon because of the Cedars Revolution and Assad as well. So that prompted the Iranian regime to go quickly under Ahmadinejad and enrich the chemicals they had, the components, and go very fast. In 2006, just 1 year before your report, I published an article in counterterrorismblog.org saying that it is not just about, you know, the fissile material, because the fissile material you can observe, you can, you know, you could contain, you could cut off, but it's also the missile. So it's not the fissile, only the missile. And this is where the Iranians went very fast on us. They put a lot of effort, especially in the previous 10 years, specifically the 8 years of the Obama administration, and before that, 1 year of the Bush administration, to perfect and develop their missile strategy. Moving forward, what really helped them, in addition to the fact that they had made that intention and had North Korean technology, Chinese technology, indirectly some knowledge from the Russians. The missiles that you just mentioned were initially Russian missiles, but it doesn't mean that Russia itself was sending them those missiles. They promoted them into a different program. But here's the deal, money. We all recall that as of 2014, Iran and the then US administration have agreed on what? On the Iran nuclear deal. What would the Iran nuclear deal provide them? The deal would tell them you're going to go slow and then reverse on producing the material, right? That's what they said they were. Now we know they were lying. But more importantly, $150 billion will be released from their accounts, including mostly in the United States and other parts, Europe and other parts, to the regime. What would they do with $150 billion? In addition to enriching the regime, in addition to suppressing the population, is to acquire what is, in my view, and the Israelis understand that, the Americans understand that, the Iran dome. You know how Israel created a dome of anti-missile missiles to protect themselves from Gaza's missiles? What the Iranians have done was to acquire the famous S-300 and S-400 Russians. Why? To protect what they will create later. So first they bought those anti-missile missiles, and then they started to perfect the long-range missiles. And there was a big dispute with France and others. The European Union said, we don't want to dismantle the agreement because there's business and, you know, interest for our companies, but we're going to talk to the Iranians not to go forward with the missiles. Well, they did go forward with the missiles. Now, over the past 3 years, there was a change. The Trump administration did a U-turn. They withdrew from the Iran nuclear deal. And on the other hand, they put very severe sanctions. In my view, though we did the right thing as, you know, Americans, it was a little bit late. The missiles have been developed. So all what is remaining for the Iranians, basically, is to equip the missiles with what I call the nuclear toys. Now, what kind, how large, how small, I don't want to go into that discussion unless you want to. But any form of nuclear device on these missiles, you know, I always tell my students, you don't develop ICBMs to throw flowers on some country far away. You nor normal traditional explosives. You only develop ICBMs to put non-conventional weapons. And non-conventional weapons in this case would be the nuclear, small tactical or strategic. Well, second remark quickly is that the Iranian potential strategic strike on Israel is not going to be only from Iran. And now we understand it. Americans understand it, Europeans and Israelis and some other Arabs for the last couple of years. The Iranian installed a system of control through militias in Iraq. We know that. In Syria and Hezbollah in Lebanon. So what is that the Iranians would want to do once they decide it's time to do? Let me summarize it, and then we can open for Q&A. The Iranians knows that the Israelis knows. It's like the Cold War time. We knew, and they knew first strike, second strike. They know that if they administer a first strike on Israel, the Israelis may even see it while coming, and then or before it's coming, and then preempt. So what the Iranians are trying to do is extend the launching pads of all kind of missiles, like a forest of missiles, starting from Iran itself. It takes, let's say, half an hour. Then from Iraq, it takes maybe 20 minutes to get to Israel. And from Syria, from Lebanon, it takes a few minutes. So what they're trying to install is a forest of missiles that would start from Lebanon under Hezbollah to saturate and target as many locations in Israel. It doesn't have to be cities, airports, airfields, radars, etc. That comes from Lebanon and Syria. And the heavy stuff would come from Iran. One point. This is why the Israelis have been over the past 3 years, despite all the revolts and revolutions and civil wars, you know, they were busy targeting any weapon coming from Iran through Iraq, through Syria into Lebanon, and more seriously in Syria. Now we understand strategically what it means. And last, the timing, Edwin, that's very important. Iran is very cautious about what timing it would dare unleash that kind of apocalypse. They want to see the main ally of Israel, ally and allies, that would be the Arabs objectively but discreetly in the Gulf, but mostly the United States, unable to respond. So when would be the peak of an American inability to respond and use its own capabilities to stop such crazy wave of attack? It would be if we have a problem within the United States. If we have uncertainties, if we have tensions, if we have urban violence, if we have any reason inside the United States that would preempt us from acting worldwide, not just with regard to Iran, would be a timing that would be chosen by the Iranians. This is why in the next coming weeks and months, all the way to after the elections, the international community, Europe, United States, the Arab countries, and Israel need to be very attentive to what the Iranians are trying to do.
Well, that was a typically brilliant presentation by you, Walid. I agree with everything you said and the fashion in which you said it. Of course, what Iran would have to do is build the wall first and then operate within that wall, which is why they have built that bubble. And of course, their plan is to overwhelm the Israeli air defenses with this force that you spoke of, which would come from the 50,000 from Hezbollah, probably 3,000 or 4,000 from Hamas, whatever the Quds force is doing over the line, and whatever else Iran can muster. So that was a very important and precise and prescient warning by you of what we're facing. Let's go to our questions. The first question that I'm going to pick, you can answer it first and I'll answer it second, because this is a very common question. And it's from Wes in Walnut Creek. And it's a mad question, so you already know where I'm going. I'm going to read the full thing because it puts a lot of context. He says, although I'm for a world without nukes, the reality is that a balance of power might be the best we can hope for at this moment. If Iran were to become a nuclear power, why would the situation be any different than the dynamic that existed between the U.S. and the USSR during the Cold War, or even the U.S. and Russia today? Mutually assured destruction, which is also known as MAD, clearly creates a deterrent, as it is common knowledge that Israel has possessed a robust nuclear arsenal for at least decades. Take it away, Walid.
That's a great question. That's the mother of all questions. I've actually addressed it in my courses at Florida Atlantic University, probably for the last 20 years or 15 in the media here. Here's the deal. We don't have a final answer to that question, but this is the difference between Iran and the Soviet Union. Soviet Union is ruled by the Communist Party. Communist Party is by essence atheist. They don't believe, you know, in afterlife. The Iran regime, though tactically speaking, is very rational, they play it very well, but ideologically, and what inspires them ideologically inspires them strategically as well. They are fundamentalists. And the essence of fundamentalism is that the real life curve, you know, happened after. That explains the concept of suicide bombing. So if the people who do suicide bombing on an individual level could go for more than that on a collective level, in the sense, if the Grand Ayatollah would tell them, do whatever you can to obliterate the enemy, they call it Satan, Allah would do the rest. See, that's their logic. It's the same for the jihadists of the Salafi as for the Khomeinists. So the risk of seeing an Iran acting rationally on the tactical level, developing nukes, bringing militias, but coupled with an irrational on the historic strategic level saying, we will go with that wave against Israel. We don't care if Israel is going to hit us, if we can achieve the ultimate goal, which is the destruction of the Zionist entity or whatever. It is a risk so large that even if it's 50-50 or less, it should be taken into consideration. So in my view, the international community with these kind of regimes cannot take that risk and rely only on mutual assured destruction.
Well, I agree with you, and I'll raise you one. Yes, the Russians and the U.S. were always mad. Mutually assured destruction throughout the Cold War. I believe that the Iranians are apocalyptic, and I would add into your presentation that Iran is of the Shia schism, and that means that they have a more apocalyptic view, and so they might be willing to embark upon this end time. Certainly, Amina Jamad was always preaching the end of times in a way that Syria or Saudi Arabia or no other Arab country would do it. So the answer to Wes is, if there weren't an apocalyptic element here where they thought the greater victory could come even in death, then MAD would apply. I would also remind our listeners that when not only suicide bombing, when the young kids were sent into battle in the Iran-Iraq war, they carried their coffins on their back because they expected to die. And of course, when Iran sent children in across the minefields, that was also with the knowledge that they would be going to heaven. Let me get another question. We have so many, and they're coming in through many modalities. This is from Rabbi Eliach, the author of Judaism, Zionism, and the Land of Israel. He's from Long Island. He knows quite a bit about the Middle East. Here's his question. What are the very different approaches that President Trump and the former Vice President Biden have with dealing with Iran? Now, I'm going to say that this show does not deal with politics, but we do deal with political analysis. And so we could deal with the analysis. So if you're comfortable with that question, you can take it first or I can take it first. Which do you choose?
I'll go with that because, as you said, we're dealing from a strategic analysis perspective. Whomever we're going to vote for in November, that's a different story. So you have two doctrines here. The Obama doctrine, which is going to be the Biden doctrine if he wins, has changed the direction with regard to the containment of Iran. As of 2009, as we all know, the letter sent to the Grand Ayatollah Khamenei, and of course the Iran deal, there was a thinking in the White House then, before Trump, that if we engage them financially, we would modify their war intentions. That's the philosophy behind it. They will make money. If they make money, they're not going to go to war.
And we took the same approach with China. We said, just give them business, and they'll come into the community of nations.
But that's not a new idea. Actually, it was prevalent on our campuses. I mean, I've been a professor, you know, for 14 years on campuses, for many, many years. Okay, so that's one. And you have arguments for it, you have arguments against it. So if a Biden administration comes to Washington, they're gonna jump immediately back to the Iran deal. Maybe they will modify a few things right and left, but that is going to be the issue. there will be no military containment, there will be no economic sanctions. If a Trump administration comes back in November, there are more questions about what they're going to do than about a Biden / Obama policy, because we know what the other side of the equation is. Most likely, a second Trump administration will continue with the policy that exists right now, meaning withdrawn from the Iran deal, putting sanctions, putting pressures. The only difference, and I preempt another question that I see coming, is that I am not sure that the idea of a strike will be the answer. However, it could be another doctrine, which is the sanctions will be followed with engagement with civil society inside Iran, which is my idea as well. I mean, I would promote whomever is in the White House to follow the most secure way to change behavior is for the people of Iran to change their, if not their regime, but at least the behavior of that regime. And we can talk a lot about it, but these are the two scenarios I'd see.
Your answer leads right to our second question, but first I'll continue my comment on what you said. I believe that if the Biden camp is installed, then strategic cooperation with Israel, military cooperation, and the strategic enterprise of containing and or demolishing the Iranian nuclear program will crumble for a number of reasons, which are political. I believe that that John Kerry will, one way or the other, come back to the fore, and there'll be a reinstatement period, and that will just really encourage Israel to go it alone with whatever it has now or shall get in the very near future. So your remark about engaging civil society. We have Max in Haifa, and Max in Haifa says, why do the Iranians want to destroy Israel? I'm going to go first on this. The Iranians do not want to destroy Israel. I and Walid and many other people have many, many friends who are Persian Iranians. After so many were killed during the Iran-Iraq war, the median age for quite a while was 25 years. Everybody was wearing blue jeans, I don't have to say. But the country has been seized by mullahs. And so this is a country that really would rather share a cup of coffee with you and get into the community of nations. But right now it's controlled by mullahs. So if the mullahs are overthrown, and that would be very, very hard because you have the Basij, which is the secret police, and they go around and they intimidate people who even speak up just a little bit. It would take a lot to overthrow them. But if they can be overthrown, then we could engage civil society in a vibrant way. Walid, what do you say?
Well, I build on what you have said. Another strategic question, because many in America and even in Europe do not understand, why is Iran, why would the Iranians, in the sense, we have to compare. In the 30s, you had Italians, and then you had the fascist party of Mussolini. They took over, and therefore they were part of that war effort. Germany at the same time. Remember, there was a Weimar Republic, and you're the expert on that, and there was a takeover by the National Socialists. The entire Cold War, the decades of the Soviets in control, the communists in control of Russia and of Eastern Europe. You come to Iran, there is Iran, the people, and we have so many good friends, and the majority of the Iranian people actually are against the regime. How do we know? 2009, the Green Revolution, millions of Iranians were on the streets of Tehran. Which we failed to support. That's an important point we could discuss. And then last year, in 2019, in 2009, there was Twitter, but now you had all the Facebook, you have every video. They were 4 months of sustained Iran protests. And recently they came back again. What would that tell us is that left on their own, the Iranian majority, the Iranian people, majority ethnic Iranians, and minorities in Iran, Kurds and Azeris, would rise against this regime. So that's why I mentioned one of the options that any administration, American administration, would have is to engage with the civil society, support them in whatever we can. That would be less expensive and less dangerous for the international community.
Okay, we move to another question. This is Susan in San Ysidro. Will this matter end diplomatically or militarily? And we'll make it a short response. I will answer first. It will not end diplomatically. It will end militarily, whether that's a severe military engagement or a subversive one. It's going to be a military solution, but I defer to my friend. Walid, what do you say?
Look, it's really in the hands of the Iranian regime itself. Neither the United States nor Israel or the Arab countries, and certainly not the Europeans, even not the majority of Iranians, would like to see any war, any confrontations. Who would start any confrontation with the Iranian regime? The Iranian regime. So if they choose to achieve their goals with military means, they will be bringing into Iran a military confrontation, after which obviously there will be settlement, diplomatic settlement. So the diplomatic settlement is not going to happen before, but after a confrontation, if the Iranian regime decides to go in that direction. That would be what I would say at this point in time.
Okay. Tyler in Palm Beach, your old stomping grounds. Can the massive ordnance penetrator destroy the Fordow nuclear facility? I'll take that one first.
Okay.
The MOP, and I think there's many more than 20 now. They've fulfilled the first contract, the massive ordnance penetrator. The stealth bombers that drop them are equipped to carry two in every payload. They fly out of Whiting Air Base in Missouri. It's a big long flight, and they come one right after another. But it might take a lot more than just Fordow. There's an extremely diverse and decentralized nuclear infrastructure. Much of it is underground. A lot of it is embedded in civilian locations. Israel knows where all this stuff is. If Israel knows, the United States knows. So the massive ordnance penetrator is just one element, should this go to war, in a very, very multi-layered and multi-dimensional military scenario that is more than a bomb, much, much more than a bomb. Yeah. So I turn it over to Walid.
Well, that's a segue exactly to my remark. In addition to your remark, I do believe that the United States military technology has all the capabilities, in addition, obviously, to players in the region, mentioning Israel, other Arab countries, maybe a couple European countries would be part of this. But basically, the West and the US have the capacities. My point, my concern, is that there are two fields that needs to be prepared for any confrontation of this sort. Number one, the alternative. Because if you bomb and strike, if Iran begins, obviously, because we're not going to do a unilateral matter here, in my view, then what would happen to that country? Who would rule it? Who would organize it? Who would bring it back to civil society and democracy? So if we engage militarily without having prepared on the political level, that would be a complicated, difficult thing. And second, most of us, we're Americans, I know we have international people with us. The domestic situation in America, we cannot go to wars or confrontations if we don't have a minimum consensus about that threat. If you look at the situation right now, the Iran lobby and those who are friendly to it have built so strong of political defenses and media defenses in this country that any simple thinking of responding, not taking out the Iranian regime, of responding to Iranian attacks, if you look at some of the newspapers I'm not going to mention, or you hear some of the politicians, you would feel that you would have to create a new unity in America about those threats before even you think about taking action.
Okay, we have a question here from Samuel in Rhode Island, and he has a long question here, but I'm going to distill it. He wants to know if Iran has embedded terrorist sources sitting right here in the United States of America. let's give it to Walid. You're the terrorism guy.
Look, there is the short answer. Let me begin with the short answer. There have been many instances where our agencies have arrested, dismantled cells on the East Coast, West Coast, elsewhere. Some of these cells and individuals have actually targeted assassinations, explosions. The last few cases happened, I think one of them in New York and elsewhere, whereby individuals were, you know, Hezbollah and Iran linked, and they were taking pictures and videos and scanning the United States potential targets. So to answer you, I'll defer to the intelligence community, which already told us that, yes, that is exists. That exists. Now, in my engagement with national security analysts over the past 14 years, the assessment, because I cannot talk about information we cannot release, but the assessment of discussions is that the Iranian regime, plus Hezbollah, plus those connected to them, have a presence within the United States, fed also by across the borders, Latin America basis of Hezbollah, which would be very dangerous to our national security. And I will stop here.
Yes, that's right. I mean, it's another show, but Hezbollah in Latin America, especially with its Iranian connections, is deeply established. Now, I have a question here from Jacob in Sweden. He says, this is for Mr. Black. You seem to know about the military situation and the exact design. First, do you know how Israel will solve this? And second, can you share with us the answer? So let me take the two questions. Do I know how Israel will solve this? The answer is yes. Second, can you share it with us? The answer is no. And Walid and I know that he who talks does not know, and he who knows does not talk. Is that correct, Walid?
Yes, yes, indeed, Edwin.
Let me go to the next question here. And I know many of you are lining up on the QA thing. We're going to get to your questions. Hannah in Washington, for Mr. Black, how did you get all those specific down to the millimeter details about the nuclear bomb in Iran when no one else could? Well, that's a good question.
Mm-hmm. we need an answer.
Yeah, I'll just try to answer it this way. I'm very diligent. I'm very careful. All this information was actually observed and deciphered and recorded by the International Atomic Energy Agency inspectors in one way or another. They made many, many reports. Walid has seen them. I have seen them. Those reports go through confidential levels, and from confidential levels, they are given over to the official channels, and from the official channels, they then go to minimally public channels. I had access to all that information from the pre-publication channels, and it wasn't just from one country, because that's insufficient. I had it from multiple countries. Then, of course, once I had my information, it had to be vetted. It had to be vetted very, very carefully. It had to be sent to the experts who know everything about the R-265 shock generator. So if you want to see the full story of what I wrote, just go to the Times of Israel, was nominated for a couple of three awards, and just type Edwin Black, Times of Israel, Iranian nuke, and you'll go right to the story of how Iran got there. Stefan in Paderborn, Germany. Will not Iran strike back if Israel destroys their facilities? I'll take it first. Yes, they will strike back, but one doesn't engage in a military activity of this time on Monday without anticipating what will take place on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. So I think it is the defense. I'm not giving away anything. It is the retaliation elements which will have to be taken out, and the defense before the actual activity of destruction takes place, if it takes place. And I would say that we are talking not about a surgical strike. We're not talking about the one that took down the Osiris, the Osiric reactor in Baghdad, or even the special facility in Syria. We're talking, in my opinion, about 2 to 3 days of military activity. But I'll turn this over to Walid. What do you say?
Wow, what a question. This is really part of what I used to discuss with high-ranking officers for 7-8 years from in a setting I'm not going to be talking about, but here in Washington with international partners. One of the scenarios that we played, war games on computer and others, was what would and when would Iran regime engage in this? Because it's true that I mentioned ideology, and you mentioned ideology, but they're not just ideological. Ideology would trigger, but basically they have their military, they have the advisors, and etc. One of the scenarios I developed, including in seminars, I could say that the Heritage Foundation, the National Defense University, is that the Iranian strategic thinking, first of all, want to ensure that this confrontation with Israel is done only with Israel, not with Israel plus the United States of America. They would have no choice, no chance, if the U.S. fully and the Israelis and maybe some couple other players in the region are confronting Iran. They won't stand. So, and that's perturbing. It means that the Iranians would want to first disengage the U.S. from the equation. They would like to disengage us from the equation. They would like also to have unfavorable relationship between the U.S. and Israel, so that if there is an engagement with Israel, the United States, instead of going to back Israel, they will sit in between Israel and Iran and say, oh, let's go for a ceasefire. So what is the ultimate, I'm not giving away anything here, but that's Iranian thinking.
We're being careful.
Okay. So Iran would like to do a limited one strike, and then stop, and everybody goes to negotiations. Why limited one strike? Iran is large, and the Iranians have said that. They can absorb. It's like the Soviet Union. They could absorb. Israel is small, and its demography is, in a way, of course, very powerful military. But one strike in one place could do a lot of harm to the Israelis and maybe force them for a second strike, but the harm is done. And the Iranians would fantasize about striking on Israel, stopping Israel from striking back by saying, let's save peace. This is one of the scenarios that the Russians, the Soviets, and the Americans had in the 60s and early 70s that could be repeated. So that would be my not so limited, but still limited answer to that amazing question.
Well, you know something, Iran talks a big game, and they have a lot of videos showing Tel Aviv burning. But in the last, shall we say, 4 to 8 weeks, we've seen strike after strike in Iranian territory or Iranian-controlled territory on the Syrian border with Hezbollah, all these different things, and they're not doing anything. So why is Iran just taking it right now?
Iran's priority is to build the infrastructure of the dome. It's like they're patiently building that bridge between Iran, Iraq, Syria, Lebanon. They want to be operating on the borders, and the two borders in question are the Golan Heights and southern Lebanon. A third mini border would be Gaza. So what Iran thinking is, the long arm may start from Iran, where it is protected by long-range anti-aircraft missiles. But they don't want to allow Israelis to do a preemptive strike. How do you do that? You take out the capacity of Israel for the preemptive strike, and then you administer that massive strike, which means that they are okay losing here, right and left, incurring losses, Hezbollah in Lebanon, and certainly the Iranians in Syria, the Iranian militias on the border between Syria and Iraq. If you read the map where Israel is striking, this is the bridge. So the Iranians are like building a bridge, and some of the soldiers are falling right and left and have some, but they want to build that bridge.
You know, this goes right into our next question.
Okay.
Fiona from London says, where does the Quds Force fit into all this? Is Iran waging a nuclear threat or a terrorism threat from Hezbollah in Lebanon and Syria? I will answer first. Yeah. Walid will answer second. The answer is they are doing it all. They're doing exactly what Walid said. They are preparing the ground with these land forces. The Quds force actually has, they're sitting on the Syrian border, and they actually have extreme battle plans on how to invade the Upper Galilee, that they already have a list of towns. They already have a list of officers who are going to take over the civilian population, who will be the temporary mayor, who will be in charge of education. They have the delusion that somehow Israel will let them take over a section of the north. And so they're actually doing all of it. The Quds Force, of course, is very dangerous, named for Al-Quds, which is the Arabic term for Jerusalem. So the answer is they're doing it all. Walid, what do you know?
Okay, to make it easier on those who do comparative politics, the Quds Force will be some sort of equivalent to the SS. So they're not the army, they're the special assault troops of the SS. In the case of Iran building that bridge through Iraq, Syria, and Lebanon, the Quds Force mission is to maintain the control of these three colonies. Imagine that Iraq, Syria, and Hezbollah-controlled Lebanon are three colonies. The Quds Force is to maintain them how? By organizing militias. That's why the U.S., when it was targeted by the militias, by the Iranians, they went straight to the head, Soleimani. That explains what is the umbrella that oversees that. And Hezbollah is part of that umbrella.
And not only did they take out Soleimani, they took out the other terrorists.
Yes, the heads of the Iraqi militias.
That's right. And everybody thought for weeks there would be retaliation, and that did not occur. We're running out of time. I'm going to go a little all over because we've got a tremendous thing. We have targeted questions for Walid. Let me just go with this last one here. This is for Mr. Phares from Deb in St. Louis. What is the most volatile or dangerous time period for any potential conflict with Iran? In other words, when do you think something might happen if it does happen?
This is a government-like question. You know what I mean? I mean,
we have a lot of government people watching us.
Yes. Look, no analyst, neither Edwin nor myself, could give you such answers. But what we can do is project. We can never predict. Political scientists or historians cannot predict, but project. So if I said earlier, a little bit earlier, if you heard me, ma'am, that Iran would like to optimize the conditions. Optimize the conditions meaning Israel operating alone, Israel operating without the Arabs, Israel operating while Hezbollah is strengthening and the militias are strengthening in Syria. If you can get all of these and add the fact that Washington should be almost neutralized, you would think of windows. One of these windows is between now and the elections. Now, this window can be used or can be missed. There were other windows before. So whenever you have all these conditions coming together, then you're going to think it's a red time versus orange time versus yellow time.
I think the reddest time would be in the last week of October. But I've foreseen many other time frames, and they never came to pass. Ladies and gentlemen, we cannot take these many questions coming in. We really are sorry about it, but I'll take one or two more. I'll answer them rapidly. Is the United States government using Voice of America Radio to influence the Iranian people? Within a bit, is that not correct, Walid? And are they broadcasting in Farsi, the Voice of America?
Absolutely. This is one of the most formidable tools that the West, the United States, would use. We did it during the Cold War. Voice of America was leading in spreading information to the Eastern Europeans. The problem is that you need to have at Voice of America, Persian program, and the other means, people who are actually in line with the policy of the U.S. administration. I mean, I don't want to expand on this, but you have to have a newsroom here that knows exactly what it is. So
now I'm going to take another one. I'm going to answer this with extreme brevity. What is the cause of the British conflict with the Iranians? Would they join the U.S. in Israel in the effort to contain Iran's drive to use a nuclear weapon? Well, let's go the other way around. What is it that the Iranians have against the British? And that might have a little something to do with a company called Anglo-Iranian Oil Company.
That's your thesis.
Which I wrote a book about. That company is now known as British Petroleum. The name of the book, let's see, is, I have it right here. British Petroleum and the Red Line Agreement, not as fat as some of Walid's books, but the United States, Great Britain basically had all the oil in Iran and in Iraq. And when Iran kicked them out, in fact, this is actually the picture on the book is the day they changed the sign. The CIA and Britain assassinated the prime minister of Iran, so that didn't go over with them very well. Now we've got another one here. Since neither side could absorb a single nuclear strike from California, the costs are simply too high. Both sides know this. On a lesser scale, nothing big like this has happened with other military options for the same reason. Well, we've already discussed the fact that Israel is speaking strategically, but it does not have mutually assured destruction. It's got another doctrine. It has nuclear ambiguity, whether or not it does or does not have 81 nuclear missile, nuclear bombs disassembled somewhere in the South, and they don't confirm or deny. And so they would use that as not in retaliation, because that's not the answer, but as a final defense. And it's out there as a discouragement from the Iranian point of view. If in fact the mullahs believe that their apocalyptic vision is more important than the survival of their people, then they can make a mistake. Do you have a brief response to that, Walid?
No, I agree. I agree with your approach, Edwin. Correct.
All right. Here's another question from Dallas. No, I answered that one already. Here's one from London. I'll just take this as our final question. When the U.S. invaded Iraq based on fake intelligence and found no weapons of mass destruction, it opened the door to Al-Qaeda. When the U.S. invades Iran, will the same travesty be repeated? The answer is, we're not going to invade Iran. Israel is not going to invade Iran. No one is going to invade Iran. It's just a question of whether we can stop Iran from trying to destroy Israel. In fact, I will say that I was the first in 2006 in Detroit, at the Holocaust Museum in Detroit, to use the word Second Holocaust, that petrodollars were financing a Second Holocaust. That was at the time of Sky High Oil. I sent that to John McCain during his campaign, and he became the second one to say, I will not allow a Second Holocaust. So, ladies and gentlemen, we're out of time. As usual, we could sit here for a couple of hours, but Walid has got a president to brief somewhere. I'll see you next week at 3 p.m. Eastern. Thank you all very much for coming. Thank you to my very special guest, Walid Phares, who is as much of a gentleman as he is a scholar. And until we return, please head over to any Barnes & Noble in the USA or any Amazon platform in 100 countries across this planet, where you can find any of my 200 book editions, such as IBM and the Holocaust, War Against Weak, and Financing the Flames. Right next to them, you'll probably find 4 or 5 copies of Walid's book. Get passwords and access to participate live in future shows at theedwinblackshow.com. You'll see a much enhanced and produced version of this show and prior episodes by subscribing to our YouTube channel at The Edwin Black Show and click that notification button. Follow me at Edwin Black Book on Twitter and Facebook. And if you want to join our show group, email me at jointheteam@TheEdwinBlackShow.com. See you next week. I am zooming out.